right, thank you for the introduction. Can everyone hear me okay? Excellent. If at any point the sound cuts out, please let me know. So I'm very excited to be here today to discuss an upcoming project, which should be launched this month, the Cognitive Connectome. You may be wondering, what is a connectome? For this, I would direct you to the National Institute of Health Human Connectome Project, which is an attempt to map all of the different connections that we have within the human brain. You can find these images as well as several other gorgeous images mapping out the structural connections within our brain. Now, how do we actually go about getting this information? My method of choice is functional MRI. Here is an MRI scanner. This is the first research-dedicated human MRI scanner in the state at University of Arkansas for Medical Sciences. When we lie subjects on the bed here, we can lift them up and put them into the bore of the powerful magnet shown here. And then we can present them visual stimuli, such as through this screen you see off to the side. We have a headset and a microphone with which we can communicate with the participant, and we also have a button box with which we can record their motor responses. So we can create a very rich environment in which to challenge cognition. And just like a cardiogram would measure your heart rate, we can challenge the brain and look at different networks of brain activity. Now, it all starts to look at functional imaging with MRI. It all starts with the hemoglobin molecule. And this is a fallback to my days in chemistry. Here's a color-coded hemoglobin molecule of each of the heme groups indicated by a different color. And you may not be able to see this, but in the middle of each of these heme groups is an iron molecule, which, as you may remember, is a magnetic element. So what we do with functional imaging is we look at the magnetic influence that hemoglobin exerts upon surrounding tissue. And what's interesting is that hemoglobin will carry oxygen through the brain, but when oxygen binds to each of these four subunits, the oxygen molecule effectively masks the magnetic influence that the iron core can exert upon the surrounding tissue. So in the bloodstream, you have a series of oxy and deoxygenated hemoglobin with and without oxygen bound to it, and a set ratio of how much magnetic influence is being exerted upon the surrounding tissue. Now, following a neuronal event, there is an initial consumption of oxygen followed by an influx of oxygen-rich blood, which offsets that ratio. And through this offset, which we can measure with a very powerful magnet like the ones we currently use, we can detect where brain activity is occurring corresponding to neuronal activity. Here's one of many examples that you can find in the literature. I picked this one because it's one of mine. Published in 2009, in which it was a project looking at the aftertaste response to both sucrose solutions, a natural sweetener, and aspartame solutions, a non-caloric sweetener. And what we found here in the, you can look between the two, and there's quite a bit of similarity, especially for the insula, which is this C-shaped structure here, which is the primary taste cortex. So we're interested to find a similar taste response to both the natural non-caloric sweeteners. But this is old hat. I mean, this is stuff that we've been doing for two decades. I will point out, you may be wondering why there's a large visual cortex response here, as you see in the posterior portion of the brain. That's because we paired the juice delivery with a visual warning. We didn't want subjects to start choking while in the scanner. So that's why you see that there. But what the direction our field is really interested in is looking at patterns of brain connectivity. And looking at networks of brain activity, which again pulls us back toward the connectome. This is one such network that's been highly replicated within our field. This is the default mode network. It is a series of 3 to 6 regions that show a great deal of correlated activity both during task and at rest. This particular network was discovered almost by mistake, as I suppose most great scientific discoveries are. Early in our field, we were looking at brain networks that became more activated during tasks than rest. And then along the way, people noticed that, well, you know, if we compare rest versus task, we get the same network of brain regions, regardless largely upon what task you're performing. And so this is just a depiction of the network, so you can see it. in better view, especially if, with a horizontal slice or a slice of the midline there. But this is really where we want to be going with the field, is looking at functional networks and not only just looking at the structural connections, which are very critical, but also the functional connections composing the brain. And I have to give a lot of credit to the Functional Connectome Project, which currently boasts over 12,000 resting state fMRI data sets. So that's 1,200 individuals engaging in a resting state scan in which they passively look at across or have their eyes closed, collected across 33 sites in the world. Now the data is anonymized, has information about age, sex, and the imaging center, as well as the imaging parameters with which it was acquired. But the best part is that it's freely available for public download. So if you really want to explore either inventing new methodologies or seeing what we all have in common with our brain connectivity, this is a great place to start. Although I will say a downside of this is that, as noted, the only demographic variables available are age and sex. So it limits the kind of nuanced analyses that we can do. Although I will say there has been some pretty amazing work just with those limited variables. For example, Dozenbach in The Science last year published an article which could predict your age based on the maturational connections within your functional networks. So going just by resting state data, predict how old you were. So it's pretty exciting stuff, which wouldn't have been possible 5 years ago if not for highly collaborative multi-site studies. Now, but why would we want to include more variables? Why would we want to start exploring individual differences? Well, one reason is to improve our understanding of neuroimaging biomarkers of mental illness. For example, there's been a large number of studies looking at emotional reactivity in the amygdala. The amygdala is an almond-shaped structure. You have one in each hemisphere, and it is especially attentive to pertinent stimuli in your environment, especially those that carry with them an emotional component. And there's been many studies looking at brain responses to both happy faces and sad faces and fearful faces, as well as pleasant environment or pleasant scenes, non-pleasant scenes, etc. And what we have found is that the amygdala can serve as a biomarker for mental illness like major depressive disorder. We see that the amygdala tends to be blunted in its response to happy and positive emotional images and exaggerated in its response to negative images. But in the past decade, actually dating back to 2001, people started looking at individual differences, for example, personality measures. And we now, there's a consensus that if you look at people who are highly introverted, they also have a blunted emotional response to happy images. If you look at people that are highly neurotic on a neuroticism scale, they'll also have an exaggerated response to negative emotional images. And if you think about the construct of depression, typically those two syndromes, high introversion, high neuroticism, accompany the disorder. So we have to take a step back and ask, are we identifying biomarkers for mental illness, or is these biomarkers for introversion, or biomarkers for neuroticism, or biomarkers for what have you? Really, the only way to get to the crux of this issue is to start looking at individual differences. We need to take a step back from looking at how we're all similar and really start looking at the nuanced differences that make us all unique. And I believe that this is a critical step, which our field is starting to accept. As of this year, we now have the International Neuroimaging Data Sharing Initiative, or the INDI. I jokingly say it was named after me, INDI, Andy. But for legal reasons, I have to clarify, no, it is not named after me. This is a collaboration across many sites. The current contributors of data are listed here. It's actually the brainchild of Michael Milham at NYU. And like the previous connectomes, the INDI is a data repository for resting state data and structural data, but also a wide variety of neuropsychological and behavioral measures. things like verbal intelligence and picture IQ, things like that. Although the new work I'm developing will take this a step forward. In addition to having resting state scans and structural scans, we're going to add on even more neuropsychological assessments and more assessments of cognition. And I've dubbed this the Cognitive Connectome. Although Cognitive Connectome, it's all about branding these days. You have to have a catchy name. I've also toyed with the CogCon. That sounds too much like a comic book convention, though. You know, I'm going to CogCon this weekend. It should be lots of fun. You should come. Or perhaps to be even trendy, it could be the Cognectome. Sorry, I couldn't resist. Now, the Cognectome will consist of 24 well-validated neuropsychological assessments spanning 8 cognitive modalities, things like attention, language, reward valuations, executive function / working memory, motor ability, visual spatial ability, memory, and affect. And it'll also include 11 canonical fMRI paradigms that have been replicated time and time and time again within our field, but in small, poorly characterized samples of 20 to 30 people tops. And this is largely a historical limitation in our field. When I first started using brain imaging, functional neuroimaging with MRI, we had one scanner that was jointly shared by the VA Medical Center of Central Florida, Shands Hospital at Gainesville, Florida, and the University of Florida. So if I wanted to get in research time, we had the sweet time of 5 p.m. to midnight in which to do all of our work. So now the scanner's a bit more ubiquitous. They're more widespread and much more accessible, which allows large samples derived through multiple site collaborations possible. Now some of these paradigms, again, will test the different cognitive modalities. For example, a Tower of London task in which you see 3 pits of different depths and 3 colored balls in those pits, and then you have a starting point and an ending point, and moving the balls one at a time, try to get the starting goal or the starting point to the end state. The goal would be to characterize this in a large normative sample of 100 or more subjects, so that we could both generate a large, well-characterized database in healthy control subjects who also undergo clinical testing to make sure there are no underlying mental illnesses. So we can not only inform how individual differences affect these brain networks that we see time and time again in the literature, but also add to it a normative sample for future testing with clinical populations like depression or schizophrenia, what have you. So that is what we're doing. We have some work coming up. In about a year, we will have more data to share with you. It should be really exciting to actually be able to map out how the networks we see are affected by things like handedness. I mean, really, if we had 1,200 subjects and just a handedness measure, that would be amazing to deal with. So I will like to leave you with a special thanks to the Psychiatric Research Institute and UAMS and my many, many collaborators at the Brain Imaging Research Center, depicted up here and here. And I believe that's all for me, so thank you very much.